Klik. Can I have your attention? One last session. You're very busy. Okay, so this is the last session for the day, and it's not a very heavy topic, so you don't have to worry. Okay, and as I said, another 45 minutes later we go refresh ourselves and come, and then we're going to be off to Prambanan. Okay, right, so we're going to discuss a little about quality management in research. Is this working? I'm not able to. I don't think this is working. That's better. This is better. I can hear my voice now. So, what does quality management system mean to you? Have you heard of this terminology, quality management system? Yes?
That's a way to guarantee that the research or the trial and the data is reliable and valid.
Okay. So it's a mechanism or it's a process by which you are sure there is both process as well as data quality. As part of this lecture, we also will look at a few definitions. What is meant by quality control? What is meant by quality assurance? And how do we do this in the context of research? Okay, so as you rightly said, when we say system, it means quite a number of activities, right? It involves people, it involves equipment, it involves methods, it involves the materials that you make use of, your procedures. So it's a whole lot of things that you do in research, but in the end, it ensures a certain standard of work. I'm sure you would have seen in very many organizations ISO 9001 affiliated or certified by ISO 9001. I see this in airport, I see this in schools, I see this even in restaurants. So basically it is looking at standards and you trying to do something in your organization to be able to achieve these standards. That's what a quality management system is. What is quality control and what is quality assurance? I'm sure you've heard of these terminologies. So what does it mean to you? Gosh. I don't know who's going to pay for that damage there. So what's quality assurance? What's quality control? Let's have some answers from you. I'm sure you've heard. So what does it mean to you? They are different? Then what is it? Yes.
So my thinking like that, the quality control is mean that the standard quality which we need to follow or we have to follow, and the quality assurance is that the guarantee of to following or guarantee of to the managing this quality which is mentioned.
But I don't see a difference. Is there a difference?
I want to say that the quality control will be the standard some quality for some clinical trial, and assurance is mean that we have to ensure to follow the, or to maintain those quality, the mentioned quality.
Okay, good attempt. Anybody else would like to look at it from another angle?
Perhaps quality control is the process, quality assurance is the result.
Okay. Another dimension. Any other thoughts? Yes? Anybody from lab background?
In the pharmaceutical industry, quality control is routinely checked about the quality about our products, and then the quality assurance is the department that make a system and then to assure that all do and just like the standards that in the system.
Perfect. Okay, so quality assurance means you're trying to do something to reach up to the standards, which means that you're training the people to do the job, you're ensuring the equipment works in the way it's supposed to, you're using procedures, SOPs. So this is what you mean by quality assurance. You're trying to do everything possible to assure the quality. First of all, as we said yesterday, as he rightly said, Indra rightly said, we need to be sure there is process quality, there is data quality. Why? Because yesterday we said results are generalizable. It's not that this research is going to be used only in that context. The results are going to be generalized and is going to be applied, right? Which means that if you do not have processes that fulfill quality, your data also may not fulfill quality, right? If we need to have process quality and data quality, we need to have quality assurance. And I think, why is data quality critical? So what if the data quality is not so good? It's okay. Let it be this way, that way. We can adjust a little bit. Is that okay? Why
it's
not?
Related to the result.
Uh-huh.
It's determined the result of our trial.
Okay. So what will happen in the end if the result is not good?
Maybe the data quality is not good too.
Yeah. So we come back and forth to the same thing. Okay? Yes?
So the outcome will be generalized as you mentioned on first day.
Yeah. So in clinical trial, basically we are trying to look at a product. It's either a drug, a vaccine, a device or something. Right? So if you ensure that the data is good and you also have research participants, when you put those participants into your research and your data is good, you're managing them well. If the data is bad, probably you are exposing them to much more risk than you would otherwise be doing, right? And remember we said, if there is a SUSAR, if there is anything adverse happening, it is tilting the risk-benefit ratio. So if your data is not good, your risk-benefit assessment is not good, which means you're putting all your current participants to risk, and your generalization is putting all the future participants also to further risk. And therefore, you need to ensure that there is data quality. Okay. So, as she rightly said, quality assurance is all those planned and systematic action, which means I'm choosing the right person, choosing the right facility, right equipment, right methods, right material, right software, everything that you can think of. You choose, you train, you put all those measures that you need to ensure quality. Because I put the right person, I put the best method, everything is best, so let me sit back and relax. What will happen? Is your mood the same every day? One fine day you're happy, another day you are in a very nasty mood. Right? So what will happen if you are in a nasty mood? You will not be doing the right job. Right? Same way with the equipment. It will function very well. How many times your mobile phone just goes blank? And you get so angry when your mobile phone goes blank. Don't you feel angry? So equipment may fail. Materials may fail. Anything can fail. Right? As a result of which, if you think I have quality assurance department and they know that everything is good, I don't have to worry. But that's not the case. Which means you need to keep checking or verifying if your person is working right, if your method is right, if your equipment is right. And that process is referred to as evaluation or a quality check. Right? It doesn't mean that if you have put everything in place, they will work. You need to have a system to check. And in research, we call them under three main categories. One is called as monitoring, one is called as audit, and another one is called as inspection. We will see the differences between these three as we go by in this presentation. So as we said, basically we are trying to evaluate because we want to know if the process is good, if the data is good. That's all. All these things are just blah, blah, blah. Okay? So quality control means you are checking every now and then to ensure all your systems are working well. Do you do quality control in your daily job? I type an email. At the end of typing an email, I look for spell check. Because I would have typed it very fast. Sometimes one alphabet this way, that way can mean nonsense. Sometimes it can be completely misinterpreted, right? So do you check like that? And that is what is quality control. We do it in our daily lives. It's just that we don't know what is the terminology we make use of for this kind of a situation, right? So we categorize them as three different methods. And the purpose of evaluation, if you need to do evaluation, first of all, you need to set a standard. Against what do I verify? I need to have something against which I need to check. So you first of all set the standards. Like yesterday we talked about the standards for the chair. Am I going to say a chair is anything with four legs and a backrest? Or I'm going to set the standard as the highest ergonomic chair? Right? In clinical research, you and I have no option about setting standards. They are already set. And you need to follow, if you're doing a clinical trial, GCP. And what's the first principle in GCP? What is the first principle in GCP? Okay, that is the broad. Remember, I showed you 13 principles. And the first principle is follow the Declaration of Helsinki and the national laws and regulation. Okay, which means that if you are doing research, your standards are already set. You need to follow Declaration of Helsinki. You need to follow all the regulatory norms in your country as well as follow GCP. If I am verifying, I'm going to verify you as an investigator against these three standards. Right? So if you do not have a standard, you do not know how to measure. So therefore, you need to have some kind of a standard or a benchmark. Okay? So then build quality. And as I said, part of building quality is everything. Having the right facility, people, equipment, processes, documents and records. So you will set up everything. And then the evaluation, as I said, falls under three main categories. So what's the difference between monitoring, audit and inspection? In your understanding, you have any idea? If all of them are evaluation, why are they different? What is monitoring? Or what is audit? Have you heard of this term audit? Can you give some input on what you know about monitoring, audit, or inspection? Any of these three? Yes?
In my department, we have a regular audit okay. of the radiographs which are rejected.
Okay.
So once a week, we sit together and see how many radiographs were repeated, and we find out what were the reasons for repeat for those radiographs.
Very good.
And reasons and how to rectify them. And we calibrate the technicians on how to...
Trying to address those errors. That's exactly what you're doing by audit. How does audit differ from inspection or from monitoring? The process is perfect. What you're saying is perfect. But why are we having different entities? Is it too much? We are spending too much money on all this? We can cut short and have only one entity? Okay, let's go into it. Monitoring is something which is the responsibility of the sponsor. It will happen systematically in all clinical trials. It's mandatory that at least at some point in time, all clinical trials need to be monitored. Auditing is done by an agency independent of the sponsor and the investigator, right? Like your ethics committee, somebody independent comes and visits you. Not all clinical trials will be audited. There will be only a certain percentage of trials that will get audited. Inspection is conducted by the regulatory authority, right? They can do an inspection of any clinical trial registered in a given country. Audits and inspections fall under two major categories. One is what is called as a routine audit or a routine inspection. The regulatory authority may decide, okay, every year I will inspect 5% of the clinical trials, which means if 100 trials are running in the country, I would like to inspect 5 trials. That's one kind. The other one is called as a for-cause audit or a for-cause inspection. The sponsor thinks there is something not going very well in a clinical trial site. It's fishy. They are recruiting too many patients. Their data is all too perfect, right? So then the sponsor would decide, I am going to audit this site. I'm sure in newspapers you have read a terminology called whistleblower. Have you heard of it? Whistleblowers, right? So sometimes what happens in the media, you will see there is a clinical trial going on in this particular province, or they are doing something far in excess of what should be done. And then the regulatory authority may say, okay, there is something going wrong, let me go and inspect. Okay? So audits and inspections are either routine or it's called as for cause. There is some problem as a result of which you need to have. But monitoring is systematic and it happens in 100% of the trials. Are we clear? Okay. So these things. They look at the informed consent forms, all the completed ones, to see the signatures are correct, the dates are correct, that you actually took a consent before you recruited the participant. Because there are so many situations where recruitment happened early and the informed consent has been taken later. That's why dates are very important in informed consent. Eligibility. Like how Jareer was telling in the previous session. Have you recruited participants that are actually fulfilling all the criteria? Randomization. Did you follow randomization? Or did you decide, okay, I like this patient. Therefore, I put him into the product group. I'm not so happy with this patient. Therefore, I put him into the placebo group or into the control arm. Did I do it arbitrarily or have I followed all the randomization procedures? Then, have you correctly administered the product? Because there are so many situations, like in Bangladesh, a lot of visceral leishmaniasis trials, it's all calculated based on the weight. So which means, did you actually weigh the patient correctly? Did you calculate the dosage correctly? Have you given it appropriately? So that's something that they look at. Adverse events, like how we were seeing this morning. Do you see good reporting and capturing of the adverse events, right? And tomorrow we will see how this data is being handled, right? All these things which you are doing as an investigator will be reviewed by the monitor or the UU. They will look at all your records. They will come and see as you are working, observation. So it's a combination of interview, observation, and looking at all your records, right? That's why if your records are incomplete, you're going to be caught during any of these processes. Okay. We also call something as internal monitoring. You don't wait for them to send. You can do these quality checks, like how Jyotsna was saying, every week they meet, they look at their radiographs. You can also have investigators meet, team meet, and you can start to look at all your data before you even have a monitoring visit. Let's look at this exercise now. do not fulfill the requirements in terms of signatures and dates, what do you do next? It's strange, no? But this is reality. We train all the investigators on GCP, on procedures, and then when we go for monitoring, this is the kind of situation we see. So what do you do now? Where is the problem? Is there a problem? What's the problem?
Investigator, maybe if the research done by investigator directly, then the problem of investigator. But if the investigator recruit some research assistant, then the investigator not monitor the assistant
mm-hmm.
regular fulfilling.
Finally, it is also the problem of the investigator
yeah.
Right? Yeah. You will see tomorrow that whatever happens as a problem in the site, the principal investigator becomes the sole responsible person. You can't say, I gave it to the nurse didn't do. Which means that you did not take attention when you recruited that nurse or when you trained that nurse. Right? So there is a problem here. What will you do now in this situation? Sit back and relax.
I think we have to audit. We have to find out the problem and to find...
The audit only picked it up. Let's say either the monitoring or the audit only picked it up. You did not pick it up as an investigator. Somebody came and picked it up for you. What will you do now? What will you do now?
Investigators should recheck the all documents, the 40 documents again, to find out the other missing. There is also missing, so...
Okay, we'll come to it. We are coming to it soon, okay? Now, as I said, there are some characteristics of an audit. Audit is basically an independent one. It's only looking at a sample. Monitoring will almost look at 100% of all your data and everything. Audit will just slice, just takes a representative sample. Think, informed consent lab, the clinic, the pharmacy, they just look at system-wise. And they check for compliance. Are you actually fulfilling your protocol, the regulatory requirements? And it's part of a quality assurance and quality improvement. Look at this cartoon. What do you see here in this cartoon? Did you observe the cartoon? What's happening here? Who is there inside this? Right? So it goes back to honesty. You can still cover up under the carpet or hide inside the wardrobe or whatever, but then the auditor is way too smart. If you ever had an audit, it's actually a nice experience because they will pick up a lot of things which you would have otherwise overlooked. Okay? So, as I said, it's all the same thing that they will review. Now look at this exercise. So this morning, you had a source document, that is the case study, and then you had the CRF, right? You put all the information that is there in that case study into the CRF, like that. They also have source documents for all the information and they put it. But then you see, neither the weight measurement nor the BP measurement is there in the source document. But all the information is perfectly written there in the CRF. And if there is information in both, they are mismatching. There's something here and there is something there. So what's the problem? Is there a problem? Is there a problem? What's the problem? How will you address the problem? Inspection is going to pick up more problems. check the data again. Okay.
We go back to the source documents.
Mm-hmm.
We go back to the source documents and then verify.
The source document does not have 80% of the BP and 70% of the. It's already not there. So even if you go further, you're not going to pick up anything. So what kind of problem you see here? So we saw two situations where we know there is a problem. So what do?
Train them.
Train them, okay. So first of all, we need to investigate, right? So whatever problems that we pick up, these are called as errors or non-conformance. In GCP jargon, we call them as non-conformance. You're supposed to conform to something, but when you see these errors, you call them as non-conformances. So I'm just coming to that very soon. So as I said, inspection is conducted by the regulatory authority. A monitor or an auditor will inform you saying, I'm planning to come on such and such a date. Is it convenient for you and your team? An inspector would say, I've just arrived in Yogyakarta. I'm in the airport. I'm in a taxi. I'm driving down. In the next 15 minutes, I will be there in your site. You see the difference? They are all powerful. They don't have to inform you. They can walk into your clinical trial site at any point in time. And that's the difference between inspection and audit and a monitoring. Which means that if you agree for a clinical trial, you should be prepared for an inspection at any point in time. That's the dictum. Clear? You understand the difference? All of them look at the same things, but the volume they look at will be different. In an audit and in an inspection, they only see a certain sample. Monitoring, they will look at everything. Right? So, whenever you pick up a non-conformance, the first thing you need to ask is, why is this non-conformance occurring? Right? And for that investigation, we have some tools. We have two very many varieties of quality improvement tools. I'm just going to show you two of these tools. So you can map all your non-conformances and see what is the non-conformance that is occurring to the maximum extent. The next step is, why is it occurring? Is it because the person is at fault? Is it because the equipment is at fault? Is it because the SOP is not good? You need to investigate and find out what exactly is the problem. If you do not investigate and find out the problem, you cannot address the problem. I may train the people, but training may not be the problem at all. There may be something else which is a problem. So in order for me to identify what action I should take, I should first of all investigate. And for investigation, I need to prioritize. I don't want to work on this one thing which is only one problem. I want to work on all those which are maximum number of problems. And informed consent, even if there are two cases where there is a problem with informed consent, is a serious issue, is a serious violation, right? So I need to look at where I have to put my efforts, and therefore I use this tool called as a Pareto chart, which is nothing but a histogram. You're just quantifying and trying to see how many kinds of errors and what numbers. And the next one is called as a Ishikawa chart or a fishbone analysis. When I know it is the person, then I try to investigate further. Is this person not trained? Or is there an attitudinal problem with this person? Is trained but still doesn't want to work well, right? I need to really go at the root cause of what is the reason why I am having this non-conformance. If I don't do that root cause analysis, whatever repair actions I do is not going to be helpful. So in those two case situations, you need to do a fishbone analysis and really hit at what the problem is, right? Once you did that, you will then plan an intervention. And that intervention, like how Nina was saying in the previous session, we categorize them as a corrective action and a preventive action. I have a problem. I need to address this problem. But if I address only this problem, the next time the problem will keep coming. I need to plug the hole, so I'm not going to have problems in future, right? So for every non-conformance, you will have what's called as an intervention. The intervention is a combination of both corrective as well as preventive action. Right? So you build quality, which is quality assurance, but you keep checking, which is either monitoring or audit or inspection. You pick up non-conformances, you investigate the non-conformance, and then you plan a corrective and a preventive action. And this whole cycle is called as the plan, do, act, which is also called as the quality improvement cycle. Right? At every point in time, we will have a possibility to improve ourselves. Like I was telling, me and Nina, we are sitting there behind and we are seeing, maybe this course we have to modify a little more. In the afternoon, we already see your attention levels are going down. How can we make this course much more interesting for you? If we just sit there and say, oh, I've given you the best material. If you didn't understand, it's your headache. Go to hell. Then it's not going to be useful. But as a trainer, we have to see what is going well, what is not going well, what can we do better, how can we improve this training, right? So in all our lives, if you look at the quality as such, quality is conformance to standards. Quality assurance, you're trying to do everything to build quality. Quality control is about checking. And finally, we look at what's called as quality improvement. And if we don't look at this improvement, we are going to be absolutely stuck and stagnant, right? So we need to keep constantly evaluating and picking up all these problems. Now, we started with the definition of quality management. So does it mean that if you have a quality management system, you won't have non-conformances? Right people, right method, right machine, right material. No errors? You will still have errors, okay? So what it means is that you are not going to be error-free. But soon as an error happens, you will pick up. So every week if I'm looking at my radiology and already picking up problems, I can improve myself constantly. But if 1 year I sit back and think I'm doing the best job, then you have a mountain of errors, right? So quality management system does not mean you're error-free, only means that you pick up all these errors. So there's a standard question that I like to ask all my trainees. What do you think is an acceptable error rate? We all know now, at the end of this lecture, we already know errors will happen, right? So what percentage of error you think is acceptable? 5%. 5%? Okay, good number. Anybody else? 1%, okay, being very realistic, optimistic. Anybody else? Okay, let's go to her example of 5%. Now, you know research involves multiple steps. Okay, when I did informed consent, I made a 5% error. My next step is screening, inclusion, exclusion. I make a further 5%. 5 into 5 becomes 25%. Now, I administer a product. I make a 5%. 25 into 5 is already 125% error. We are not talking about a one-step process. Our process has got multiple steps. And it has a multiplication factor. If I make a mistake here, it's going to get reflected there and there and there and there. So if in the beginning I say 5%, by the end of my trial data will all be garbage. I cannot make use of my trial data. So is this 1% okay? Because 1 into 1 into 1 into 1 is all 1%. Is it okay? So what do you think? 0.1%? 0.5%? Give me some numbers. Half? 2.5? Okay, you're bargaining now. Okay. So, let's look at what is a 1% error in France. Okay? A 1% error in France means 14 minutes without water or electricity, 50,000 parcels lost by postal services, 22 newborns falling from the midwife's hands, 600,000 lunches contaminated by bacteria, 3 bad landings in Orly Airport. That is 1% error in France. Can we afford to have this? So can you imagine what it will be in your research? Maybe you gave the wrong product to the wrong person. Is that acceptable? Right? So which means that what we think as 1% only, when you translate it, it's a huge number of non-conformances, and it's unacceptable. If you're going to have 3% or 3 bad landings in Orly Airport per day, then imagine the other airports in the world and how many accidents you should be having on a day-to-day basis, right? And therefore, we say we work with what is called as a zero-defect heart attitude. I work with the intention that there will be 0% error. But there will be errors. I don't work with the intention I can allow a 1% or a 2% error. I do everything possible, so I want to keep it at 0%. But I know it's not realistic, and therefore I keep up picking up all the errors, and I keep addressing the errors as and when they happen. Right? So, quality improvement is the key. If you sit back and think you've got the best, I'm extremely sorry, you're in the worst situation. Right? There's another feeling that people have. Quality means it's a lot of money. What do you think? Does it mean a lot of money, or no quality means a lot of money? Let's take a lab, okay? The lab always does quality control. So I collected 25 samples, I tested 25 samples today. And today the quality control failed. So what do I do now? You go back to your Ishikawa investigation. I need to find out whether it's the machine, it's the material, it's the method, it's the person, it's everything. So by the time I get a correct quality control, I have repeated these 25 samples at least 4 times. 25 to 4 is 100 times. Whereas I should have done only 25 times. Right? When you do not fulfill quality, you spend a lot of time trying to find out what is wrong, where something went wrong. And you keep repeating and repeating till you get at it correctly. And therefore, no quality is going to cost you much more money than getting things done right in the very first time. So don't go back with the impression quality means a lot of money. No quality actually means hell lot of money. Therefore, it's better for you to have quality, right? So, in order to summarize and extrapolate the whole thing to a research context, you set the standards, you build to be able to achieve the standards, and then you check. So if you transcribe that into this, so we are building all the SOPs, the protocol, the training, buying the best equipment and everything. And then we are working. But then what's important is that you keep checking. You have monitoring, you have audit, you have inspection. You pick up all the non-conformances and you address it. Right? So this is called as the plan, do, check, act. And that's called as the 4-stage quality improvement cycle in ISO. Okay? So I think we are going to see this tomorrow and therefore I'm not going to bore you with all this now. So do you think you need to have quality in your research? You're convinced that you need to have quality, because the end result is going to decide whether you are going to accept a product as safe and efficacious, or you're going to dismiss a product as unsafe and not efficacious, right? Have you ever thought of these when you did your, not necessarily your research, your routine activities? Have you thought of something like this? Because quality management system today is applicable in every walk of life. It started in the production industry, as somebody was rightly saying, it started there in the production industry. But now, everywhere, even in schools, they look at it. Do I have the right teachers? Am I able to finish all the syllabus on time? How are my students performing? Why are they not performing well? Should I do something better to improve their performance? So this quality management system and these concepts are universal, and they are applicable in all settings. And research is no exemption from this. Any questions? You okay? Okay. So if there are no questions, so we started this morning with informed consent. And you know, informed consent is to respect the right for a given individual who's autonomous to make their own choices. And then we went through all the details about informed consent. From informed consent, we then moved on to safety management. We looked at a lot of definitions, and we said these definitions are very strict. You cannot change these definitions. These are regulatory requirement. And the most important in that session is that there are certain serious adverse events which are unexpected, but which are also an adverse drug reaction, and those are called as SUSARs. They are the most important because they are the ones that tilt the risk-benefit ratio. And that needs to be reported to ethics committee and to the regulatory authority. Then in the afternoon, we started off with a session on product management, right? How important product management is, because you're testing this very correct product. If you didn't manufacture the product, if you didn't store the product correctly, if you didn't dispense the product correctly, the purpose of your clinical trial can get absolutely defeated. And so it's important for you to handle the product very, very correctly. Then we moved on to the session where we spoke about recruitment and retention. If you want to recruit and you want to keep your criteria extremely tight, then you're going to face issues. But if you want to retain patients, you have to have very strict criteria. Therefore, you need to have a balance between what kind of inclusion-exclusion criteria that you will have. But more importantly, you need to be sure you have a patient population adequate, so then you will be able to recruit. Plus, there are always socio-cultural differences. What works in one country may not work in another country. So you need to keep all these factors into consideration. And we finished the day with a session on quality. We spoke about quality assurance. It's about building quality into the system. And we spoke about quality control, which is about verifying. And we said there are three main measures. One is monitoring, the other is audit, and inspection. An inspection by the regulatory authority is very stringent. They can just walk in any time. Audit may or may not happen, but monitoring happens systematically, right? They're going to look at all the processes, all the data. And if something is not right, we call it as a non-conformance. When you identify a non-conformance, you need to investigate. You investigate and you don't sit back, you act. And the action can be a corrective or a preventive action, right? And once you do this, it doesn't mean you can sit back, because tomorrow a person can fail, tomorrow a machine can fail, tomorrow a method can fail. And as long as you are doing your research, you will have to constantly keep checking, evaluating, picking up non-conformances, address them. And this quality improvement is key to the success of any research program. Right? You, I know you will be very busy this evening in the Ramayan ballet. Go and sleep. Tomorrow morning, Jarir is going to pounce on you, asking you for findings, recapitulation, so you can keep these as your summary points. Okay? So if you have no questions, we can close the session for today and perhaps give the floor to Katoot. She may have announcements sitting behind. Don't feel inhibited to ask me any questions, huh? Just keep asking, because the best way to learn is also to keep asking a lot of questions. And if you understand why you do something, you will automatically start asking, what should I do and how should I do? But if you have doubts on why you should do something, you go on thinking about why do I have to do, why do I have to do, right? So you always ask this question. Katoot, you have announcements for them? Let's give a very big hand, because today has been a very long and strenuous day for you guys.